Doug, a week three that keeps up with the theme, right? We saw some crazy games. We saw some crazy results. But let's jump right into one of the best players in the league, somebody who can't seem to get enough credit for what he's doing. Feels like we talk about him every week. But through the first three games of the 2022 season, Lamar Jackson leads the league in touchdown passes with 10. He leads the league in passer rating at 119. He's also tied with Christian McCaffrey for fourth in rushing yards in the NFL with 243. He's also the first player in the Super Bowl era to record at least three touchdown passes and 100 rushing yards or more in consecutive games. He won the NFL MVP unanimously at the end of the 2019 season. If he keeps up this pace, Doug, or anything near it, are we really just boxing everyone else out of the discussion at this point for a second time, really?
Yeah, not bad for a wide receiver, tight end, or long snapper.
He's a running back. He was a running back. I was promised he was a running back.
We got to give Bill Polian a break because he did apologize. at this rate, I don't think anyone else is catching him. Josh Allen and Jalen Hurts might, if you haven't watched Jalen Hurts, believe me, it's there. Might catch a few votes, but this is Lamar Jackson's NFL right now, and everyone else is just paying rent, which is the title of our article I'm working on today. Were he to never run the ball, he'd still be an MVP candidate as a pure quarterback. And were he to only run the ball, he'd get a few mentions as an offensive player of the year candidate. I mean, this is rare. Moreover, Pro Football Focus is charting. This is from Monday morning. Jackson has thrown from the pocket this season 88% of his passing attempts. Put a pin in that. Completing 66% of those attempts for 9 touchdowns and 2 interceptions. If this prorates over the entire season, Jackson won't just be the NFL MVP. He'll also be, and this is something we need to do as a list down the road, the all-time contract year champion. No question about it.
I mean, like I said, I could have sworn that he wasn't capable of being a successful starter, especially a pocket passer in the NFL. Oh, right? No. That's what we kept hearing. And we've been hearing this.
He was awesome from the pocket in 2020, and he didn't have a pocket in 2021, but he's still not a good pocket passer, even now. No.
And again, the ridiculous thing to me is that winning the MVP didn't silence any of that, right? Everybody just assumed, you know, the haters still found a way to say, well, you know, he's only like that because the offense is built around his ability to run. I feel like he transcends that offense, and I feel like his ability to succeed in the pocket as a passer this year is just blowing that ridiculous, false, tired narrative just out of the water. So all he keeps doing is things.
It's funny how Josh Allen, by the way, can win in design runs and still get esteem as a passer. I wonder what's different.
I wonder what it is. What could it be?
Maybe it's a height thing.
Maybe that's what it is. That's what it's got to be.
Height. Okay. Anyway.
Listen, I mean, he keeps doing is stuff that nobody in the league has ever done. If he keeps up this pace, he should run away with the MVP award. Whether or not it happens, we'll see. He's proven he can do it because he did it before. But, I mean, you know me. You know how I feel about Lamar and how I felt about him since that draft. So I'm just going to keep back sipping my tea every time he carves up a Bill Belichick defense for 4 touchdown passes.
Yep. Put up the Kermit tea meme right there.
It's delicious. It's delicious.
Lovely. Lovely.
Speaking of quarterbacks, two former NFL quarterbacks and current NFL analysts were kind of bailed out from their worst moments in their career on Sunday, right? We had former New York Jets quarterback Mark Sanchez, who's a Fox Sports analyst now. He might not have to hear about the butt fumble ever again after the butt punt from Thomas Morstead in the Miami Dolphins Sunday. And can't believe those words just came out of my mouth, and it's fantastic. But after that, Jimmy Garoppolo said, hey, hold my drink here. We're going to go and make sure that Dan Orlovsky never has to hear about running out of the back of the end zone again, because I'm going to do it. I'm not only going to do it, I'm going to step out of bounds. And right after I do, I'm going to throw a pick six just as the cherry on top. So, man, just what a great weekend for quarterbacks who have had to hear their entire post-NFL careers about the one mistake they made in that one moment. But if we were to turn this around, Doug, what is the one football moment in your lifetime that you wish somebody else would eclipse, and what would it be?
I wrote it. Thanks to Dan, by the way. I wrote a story about that last night. I got a quote from him. Dan's a great guy and hell of an analyst. Really good. The moment, well, Luke, I live in Seattle. I mean, I've had fandom beaten out of me over the years, but as I am a Seattle resident and also a fan of passing concepts that aren't the dumbest in NFL history, I keep waiting for another team besides the Seahawks to run something as ridiculous as the skinny slant to Ricardo Lockette, intercepted by Malcolm Butler, that ended Seattle's chances against the Patriots in Super Bowl 49. Chris Corder, our awesome producer, hi Chris, is going to put up a picture of that play right now just to prove my point. I know he will. Whenever a quarterback does throw an interception into the opposing end zone or does something equally ridiculous in a playoff game, everybody in my city has to deal with replays of that play, most likely with grunge music in the background, and then a cut to somebody in Pike Place Market either making lattes or throwing fish. Luke, you've been in Seattle, you know exactly what I mean. It's time for a new narrative. Luke, what is the one thing you'd like somebody to just evaporate here?
See, it's hard for me to think about now because you say Pike Place, and now I need like red chowder and a salmon sandwich from Market Grill. And
thank you.
Some schnitzel fingers and some humbao, man. Now
Matt's at the market, baby. We need some endorsement. Yeah, Matt's at the market. Come on, bring it.
I love it. I love it. But I mean, you talked about your you know, growing up in that area and being a fan. I'm going to cheat a little because this happened before I was born. But when you grow up in Tampa as a Bucs fan, you are born into losing. You have 0-26 attached to everything about your favorite franchise. And similar to what you said, every time there's a team that loses enough games in a row, it eventually gets to the point where like, oh, hey, you remember the Bucs lost their first 26 games in a row. And then they have the montage of all the most ridiculous, stupid blunder plays that the Bucs made throughout 76 and 77.
Steve Spurrier at quarterback. Gotta love that.
I mean, it was so bad. I mean, and they got good really quickly after that.
Yes, they did.
But again, and this is a decade before I was born, but still, you know, at that point, they had had that nice spurt where they were good from like 78, 79 into 80. And then they got really bad for a long while until really the mid-90s when Tony Dungy came along. But yeah, I feel bad even. It's so bad that I don't know if I'd wish it on another team to have to go 26 games without winning. I don't know that I'd wish that on any fan base. But if somebody did it, I know that Bucs fans, especially lifelong, like grew up in this area, people such as myself, sure wouldn't mind that 0-26 not being the record anymore.
79 Bucs, one game away from the Super Bowl, just saying.
Leroy Selman, baby. Leroy Selman. Every time. 79-99.
Yeah.
Terrible. Speaking of the playoffs, though, we have 8 teams. The Ravens, the Bears, the Browns, the Broncos, Jaguars, Dolphins, Vikings, and Giants, who have won at least 2 of their first 3 games this season after missing the postseason in 2021. Which of these teams do you think is the most credible threat to actually do some major damage to the rest of the league throughout the rest of the year?
Yeah, Giants are a maybe or maybe not because they're playing Monday night. We're taping this Monday morning. As bullish as I am about the Dolphins, and I deserve a reason to be, I think the Jaguars more and more are the team on this list the NFL should be most afraid of and worried about. They're not 3-0 like the Dolphins are, but I think they might be tougher to beat over time. We've already talked about the massive upgrade from Urban Meyer to Doug Peterson because it couldn't get any worse. It's time to get past that. After their 38-10 demolition of the Chargers on Sunday, this team ranks 2nd behind the Bills in overall DVOA. They rank 5th in offensive DVOA. They rank 4th in defensive DVOA. Their defense is totally for real. And it seems as if they've hit on absolutely every single one of their free agent acquisitions and draft picks in 2022. So Trent Baalke, my apologies, everyone's apologies. Talk about sipping tea. Trent Baalke, their GM, is sipping tea right now. They're 2-1 because they lost a close one to the Washington Commanders in the season opener when they were still trying to figure a few things out. Spoiler, they have figured those few things out. Luke, what about you?
I mean, I love what the Jags are doing. I'd love to see them succeed. I'll stay in the Sunshine State, but I'm absolutely going with the Dolphins. I mean, they're playing such good football on both sides of the ball. They've got playmakers all over the place. They can impact the game in every phase, which means every moment, no matter what their opponent is doing, they have somebody who can counter it. They have somebody who can make the play to stop it. And I think they're just the type of team that's going to be a tough out for any opponent that doesn't go into that game bringing their A game. And if they stay healthy, I think what we saw on Sunday is they proved they can challenge the Bills for that division. And if you had said that a week or two ago after what the Bills had done the first couple of weeks of the season, I mean, you would have thought anybody saying that was crazy. But after what we saw Sunday, I think it's legit.
I was a little concerned about their defense until that game. And I know that, you know, they had 13 Bills, like, you know, having heat issues and whatever, but still, that defense came to play, and it was very impressive.
Now, to wrap us up, Doug, through the first 3 weeks of the season, who would you tab as your secret superstar, which is one of my favorite articles that you guys do over at Touchdown Wire, picking out every week, the players that kind of fell under the radar but had a huge impact on their games. Through these first three games, though, who is that one player across the league who is has stuck out and deserves more attention for the impact they're having?
Well, I can see right now that two of your guys will be on my Secret Superstars article this week. My guy, he's not much of a secret anymore, but I want to bring Lions receiver Amon-Ra St. Brown more into the spotlight because I think we're talking about him, but we're not talking about him enough and at the right level. The 2021 fourth-round pick out of USC took a minute in his rookie year to make his presence known. But in the second half of the 2021 season, weeks 10 through 18, he ranked sixth in the NFL in targets with 78, third in receptions with 63, fourth in receiving yards of 662, and tied for fourth in receiving touchdowns with 5. St. Brown has done everything possible to prove none of that was a fluke. Through three games in 2022, he ranks fourth in receptions, ninth in receiving yards. He's tied for second in the league with 3 receiving touchdowns. This is all with Jared Goff at quarterback in a run-heavy offense, which St. Brown, by the way, has also helped to contribute to with 2 sweep runs for 6, or reverse runs, excuse me, for 68 yards and a touchdown. He's tough when he needs to be. He's a willing blocker, and he can win wherever you put him on the field. He's not just a slot guy or an outside guy or whatever guy. He's everything. This is a legit number one top 10 receiver who needs to be talked about in that way going forward. That's it.
Yeah, I love what he's doing. I really loved him coming out of USC in that draft. So it's great to see him again, like you said, even in an offense where you would look ahead, even from like a fantasy perspective, right? You look at situation, you look at his quarterback, the scheme, and you'd think, man, that's just not a situation where a guy like that can shine. But he has obviously proven otherwise. This is where I am going to show the Jags some love, though. I mean, obviously, lots of things are going right in Jacksonville, even just because Urban Meyer is not the one in charge there. And obviously, Trevor Lawrence being the quarterback, he's going to get a lot of the credit for that, and rightly so. But I think James Robinson and Christian Kirk, I'm going to cheat and pick two here. I think they deserve a really huge chunk of that credit, right? We assumed coming into this season that Travis Etienne, who was a first-round pick last year, he missed the whole season, but he's back healthy. Okay, he's going to, you know, be the dynamic playmaker out of this backfield, and Robinson's going to kind of take a back seat here. Somebody forgot to tell Robinson that because he's been the workhorse. He's been keeping tons of pressure off Lawrence in the passing game because he's been so effective on the ground. And pivoting to Kirk here, when he signed that massive contract, I think most people, myself included, looked at that deal and what he had done in Arizona and just wondered how in the world he could reset the receiver market like that based on the sample size we had. And he took a lot of criticism. All he's done, I think, to this point has really been worth every penny. I don't think the Jaguars feel bad about that deal at all right now. He's giving Lawrence a big play threat down the field, and he's clearly developed chemistry with him very quickly and trust with his quarterback. And that's just, it's worth so much, and it's clearly showing up on game day, and it's a big reason why the Jaguars are where they are right now.
Yeah, the Kirk deal is more Trent Baalke sipping tea, hello, and Robinson, he had to overcome two things last year. Urban Meyer forgot who he was in favor of Carlos Hyde, whatever, and then he tore his Achilles 9 months ago. I mean, he's probably comeback player of the year. He is, I believe, yeah, he's the only player per ESPN Field Yates this year, Highfield, who has a rushing touchdown in each of his first three games this season. I mean, this is, it's one more of those remarkable stories where you save a culture and come in and do these things. And yeah, both of those guys, I mean, all those guys, I could mention Darius Williams, the cornerback. I could mention Devin Lloyd, the linebacker, who was absolutely impossible against the Chargers. You could mention 5 or 6 guys on the Jaguars. And that's one of those reasons that certain teams, because we all talk about, you know, the top guys, it's not stars and scrubs. If you get the scrubs right, you have the depth to go on those big playoff runs, and that's exactly where they are.
It is exactly where they are, Doug, and where we are is moving on to week 4. Can't wait for another week of NFL action. If it's anything like the first 3 weeks, we are in for quite an adventure. So thank you, the fans, for joining us for another episode of 4 Down Territory. Once again, for Doug Farrar, I'm Luke Easterling, and we will see you next week.
Take care, everyone.